Easter. Why don't you stand and worship with us this morning?
Used to say that the phrase is "He is risen indeed." Following, can we do it again? He is risen. He is risen indeed. Would you be seated for just a moment, please? We are so glad that you are here. If you are new to us today, we would love for you to visit the Connect Center right out those doors and a little bit to your left. Immediately following our service this morning, we have a gift for you and would love to get a little better acquainted with you in that. So please stop by and see that. We believe in discipleship here, and by that we mean that we think following Jesus and obeying him is really important. And part of what he talked about to us is giving and how important that is for his kingdom. We are a part, Gateway is a part of a global church the Church of the Nazarene, and we are in 165 world areas. And so on Easter, we try to take a special offering to help with others, our family. You know, when the family needs help, the family rises to the occasion and helps, right? And so we want to help the family around the world. So if you have a gift today that you would like to put in for that offering, we would appreciate it. Of course, we're going to receive the normal tithes and offerings for the advancement of the kingdom here in this local church as well. Our ushers are coming, and I just want to have a word of prayer with us before we take this offering together today and just thank the Lord for who he is, what he's done. Would you bow your heads with me? Heavenly Father, we love you today. We thank you for your presence, your Holy Spirit. We've already sensed in this place. We thank you for how special this day is, what happened on the cross, and then what you did 3 days later, raising Jesus from the dead. We just celebrate that together today. We are so grateful for what you have done, your plan of salvation for us. And Lord, just out of hearts of gratitude, we want to give back to you. So we say yes in every area, even in our giving. We love you supreme, and we pray this in Jesus' name. And together, God's people said, amen. Thank you.
So a lot of times in our lives where we can experience the darkness, the loneliness of Good Friday. But the hope is that Sunday is coming. Listen to this song. A great light dawns in Galilee. Some say madman, some say king. Wonder-working rebel priest. Jesus Christ the Nazarene. And he knew well what it would take to free us all from sin and grave. A perfect man would have to die, and only he could pay that price. Friday's good 'cause Sunday's coming. Don't lose hope 'cause Sunday's coming. Devil, you're done, you better start running. Friday's good 'cause Sunday's coming. Soldiers take him in as his friend betrayed him with a kiss, and there before a mocking crowd, like a lamb to the slaughter, didn't make a sound. Then he carried that cross to Calvary, and he shed blood to set us free. As the nails went in and the sky went dark, the redemption of the world was on his heart. Friday's good 'cause Sunday's coming, and don't lose hope 'cause Sunday's inside the angel. all heaven sings to him alone. And we watch and wait like a bride for her groom. Oh, church, arise, he's coming soon. Amen. Would you give him praise? Would you give him glory? One of my favorite phrases during Easter is what Pastor has already said. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Would you turn to someone around you and just say, he is risen indeed, and welcome them.
He's risen indeed.
Meet a new friend today.
Lila, he's risen indeed.
I hope your name is written down in that book as well. And if it is, that you know that because he lives, I can face tomorrow.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to seal my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives.
And love. was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you had me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owed. You broke my chains, you freed my soul. For the first time I had hope.
Thank you, Jesus, for the
Lord.
We have much to be thankful for today and give him glory, don't we, church? Can we just thank him together? Father, we're so grateful for your presence here, for your plan of salvation in our lives, the hope that we have in you because of Jesus. We celebrate that today. And Father, I just pray that you would help us to be a people who celebrate it and live it and share it, because we want everyone to know this joy, this relationship that we have with you because of what Jesus has done. So this time together, Lord, today that we have to spend in your word, we know your spirit will speak to us. Would you help each of us to be bold enough to respond to you in obedience today, we pray, and to say yes in everything that you ask of us. We love you. We thank you. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Please be seated if you would. Thank you.
We all want life.
Again, we're just so glad that you're here today. We're going to look at a few stories together this morning.
Followers of Jesus.
And I just want to share a story with you, if I could, for a moment. Back in January of 2019, it was December of 2019, I had a heart event. Many of you have heard a lot of this story, but I just want to share a little piece of it with you today. It was one of those moments where it was a heart attack that really took me out, and the next thing I remember is waking up with these giant eyeballs looking at me, and one of them had a set of paddles in his hands, and I knew that there must have been some serious activity going on while I was out, and God brought me back to life. Can I just tell you, I am so grateful for that moment, and it has changed so much perspective for me. The way I think about things has changed from that moment. I was at, well, I guess it would be worst, although, you know, in those moments of death, what does the scripture say? That we're with Jesus. Those who are in Christ are with him. So for me, it might have been a really glorious thing, those moments, but I think for my family, and hopefully for some of you at least, you were ready for me to come back for this season. And I just changed, yeah, well, thank you, Pete. I just changed the way that I thought about things. I've got one fan here. In so many ways, the attitude, just the way I think about things. And so I went from probably the very worst moment someone could have to having the very best moment. And it was because of Jesus and encountering him. It was all because of him. Can I make a statement to you today that wherever you are, whatever challenging situation you are currently in, that you find yourself in now, however broken or jaded that you have become, Jesus is able and willing to resurrect all the dead in your life. That's a good word for us today, and it's right here. We see that today. So I want you to think about the death in your life today. The things that just bring you down, that are so discouraging to you, the things that maybe you're worried about, spending a lot of emotional energy on. I want you to think about those things. Could we just label those as death in our life today? Can I tell you what? Jesus is greater, and he wants to go through all of that with you. There's a verse in John 11. We're going to look at this passage a little bit later today, but I just want us to grab this as a key verse for us this morning. And it's John 11, 25, and it's Jesus speaking to Martha in this moment, actually. And he makes this statement, but it applies to each and every one of us. He said, I am. Remember the song where we were singing about the I am? Jesus calls himself I am. I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live even though they die. Oh, there's great truth there. What does he mean? What is he talking about? What is this death that he's trying to get us through to the other side? He's talking about the death that sin brought into our lives. So in Genesis chapter 2, I want to show you this passage of scripture because it really tells the story. Chapter 3 is about the fall of humanity, Adam and Eve. We know that story. But look at this scripture in Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 to 17. The Lord took the man, put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and care for it. And the Lord God commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat of it, listen to this, you will certainly die. Now, we know that Adam and Eve didn't die immediately physically right then, although they ended up dying later, yes. So it brought in physical death, but that was delayed. But what was immediate? It was immediate, the spiritual death that took place. And so we are living within that. And what Jesus is saying, hey, I'm the resurrection and the life. When the resurrection and the life comes on the scene, we have great hope, church. Aren't we grateful for that? But what took place in the garden ushered in spiritual and physical and relational death. The things that are just challenging to us, all of that came there when sin entered the world. The earth was cursed. We have weeds now. We have storms. We have untamed animals. We have evil. We have war. We have murder. We have all of this stuff, and we're in a mess. And I think we would all agree. And yet, in the midst of it, we have Jesus. Praise his name. Look at some verses about what sin does. We just sang about how it separates us. Isaiah chapter 59, verses 1 and 2. Surely the arm of the Lord is not too short to save, nor his ear too dull to hear. But your iniquities, another word for sin, have separated you from God. Our sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. Romans 3:23, for all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. In Romans 5:12, therefore just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all people because all sinned. That doesn't sound very hopeful, does it? Well, can I tell you, that's why Jesus came, and we have great hope. So what difference does the empty tomb make for us today? Jesus took our punishment. He paid the penalty to restore our relationship with God. I want you to look at this in John 5, because there's a condition upon this. Just check this out with me. It's verse 24. It's very truly, I tell you, whoever hears my word, believes him who sent me, has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. All of that death in us, we have victory over it in Christ. But look at the condition here, folks. Whoever hears my word and believes. And that word believes is so much more than just head knowledge or, you know, even understanding. It's so much fuller than that. It's accepting. It's living out. So what we want to do here this morning is look at four quick stories about what God has done in some people's lives, how he brought them back from literally death to life. The first one we're going to look at is Lazarus. And it's there in John chapter 11. We read one of those verses before. Can I just tell you that Lazarus represents to us someone who has experienced disappointment in life. Any of you ever experienced any disappointment in life? Yeah, I think we all understand that. Do you know that Lazarus's name, his very name, means God is my help? And how fitting for him in this story. He grew up in a godly home. He was a really good man, and he had strong relationships within his family. His sisters loved him very dearly. He probably was the provider for them. It doesn't sound like they were married at this time, and it sounds like he was their provider, and there was such great sadness in the midst of what was taking place in his life. There was so much good, and then all of a sudden he got sick. And so he epitomizes for us today, church, the person who lived a good life and who was doing well, and yet all of a sudden sickness came in and took away everything, and not just for him, but for his family. So you can see the tension. You can see the stress here. You can see how upset they were when they sent word to Jesus, hey, your really good friend Lazarus is sick, and Jesus waits 2 days before he even goes. And when Jesus shows up, Lazarus is already in the tomb 4 days. He's been dead 4 days. Where were you, Jesus? You ever felt like that? I want to show you some scriptures here in this story. We see in verse 5, right there, he loved them. Verse 6, so when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 days. He delayed. Mary and Martha noticed it. Jesus comes into town. Martha runs out to meet him. And one of her first words to him in verse 21 is, if you would have been here. Have you ever gone down the what if road? You know that road? If only. If only. Jesus, if you would have only. And then in verse 32, we see the same thing, except it's the sister Mary. She finally comes out. She was in the home, waited. Martha was already out talking to him. Now Mary comes out, and she says the same thing. Jesus, if only you would have been here. Have you ever thought in the if only mentality? It takes us down a really bad road. Here's the other piece of the puzzle. What they were thinking was limiting the power of God. If only you would have been here, he wouldn't have died. And Jesus is like, I'm here now. I'm the resurrection and the life. Are you ready to see something happen? Are you ready to live? Are you ready to experience and encounter Jesus like you've never experienced him before? And Lazarus epitomizes those of us who have been disappointed in life. Can I tell you? The resurrection and the life. That was perfect accent. The resurrection and the life is here, and he's ready to do some work in our lives. Amen? He's here today, and he's ready. Oh, goodness. I think there was even a little anger with God. If you had been here, boy, you waited 2 days. Maybe some of you are to that point. Can I tell you? If you'll latch on, if you'll believe with head and heart, I think you'll see a miracle. There's another story. I love this story as well. It's the woman at the well. We find this in John's gospel, and it's in chapter 4. This woman was treated as an outcast. Have you ever felt like an outcast? She didn't have any friends. Have you ever felt like you don't have many or any friends in your life, that there's no one you could turn to, and you're just kind of on your own? And so many things in her life just kind of stacked up to bring her to a point where I just think she was jaded. I think she was just going through the motions. The time of day that she's at the well signifies the heat of the day, midday. It signifies that she wanted to be there by herself. She didn't want the scorn and the ridicule from others because of the lifestyle she was living. And so she tries to sneak in at a time where no one else would be there. And Jesus knew that. And he's sitting there at the well when the disciples go back into town to get some food. He's there waiting. You know what? Jesus is waiting for you today. Isn't that an awesome thought? Whatever you're sensing or you're feeling or maybe you're experiencing or maybe the situations in your life right now, Jesus is waiting, and he's just ready for the conversation. Of course, he engages the conversation, because what we know about the relationship between Samaritans and Jews was not good. There was a strained relationship. We kind of see that today in the Middle East, don't we? A little strained relationship. Well, it was beginning at that time, well before that even. And so this woman who was treated like an outcast, who was really a piece of property because she had had 5 husbands, and women in that age, and it was so wrong, but they were treated like property. She was caught in systems and situations and even prejudices that kept her bound. Yeah, she made some bad choices. We're not taking away any of that, but there was also some things that happened in her life that were really no fault of her own, and she was just stuck. She was caught and trapped in this and just kind of going through the motions. Race, gender, traditions of her people, the Samaritan people. How about the warped theology of the Samaritan people? Have you read that passage? Check it out sometime this week. Just go into it thinking about what they thought about God. It was warped. It was pluralism all in there. It didn't make any sense. And that had been passed down, and that's what she had understood and accepted. And she was just trapped in so many ways. And it really created the perfect storm in her life. Yet Jesus engaged her in conversation and called her out of a life of sin. Well, go call your husband and have him come back, and I'll give you this living water. Well, I don't have a husband, sir. Well, you're right. You've had 5 husbands, Jesus said, and the man you're currently living with is not a husband. He was calling her out of that lifestyle, because what we know in Scripture is that sexuality is a gift from God, and it's a covenant relationship between one man and one woman for life. And he was calling her out of that. He in love, he was embracing her. I mean, no one else in the community, there was a form of morality in the community, but it was the form that shunned her and pushed her away and caused her to come at midday when no one else was there. Church, we should be a people who stand for morality and reach out to everyone. Amen? Everyone. Can I just tell you, wherever you are in your walk in life, you are loved and welcomed here. Can I also tell you something else? Trans Day needs to be celebrated for those who repent completely of their sin and allow Jesus to transform every part of us. That's Trans Day. And how strange it is that that day falls on Easter today, but if we're celebrating Jesus, we are living for him, obedient lives to his word, and we're reaching out to others to help them be transformed by the grace of God. Amen? Help us, Lord. Help us to be loving and gracious. What's the word I'm looking for? Very gracious in our approach to others. Help us, Lord. I want to show you this scripture because there's something at the end of the story that's really remarkable. This is verse 28. It says, "Then leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people." You realize the whole reason she came to the well at that moment was to draw water, right? I mean, she was working. She was taking care of daily tasks. And the whole reason she was there was to carry the water and to bring it back to whomever in the family. And she left it there because something happened, an encounter with Jesus happened. And she went back and told the people, the very people that had rejected her. Now, all of a sudden, something took place. And while we don't have the whole story of that conversation, in there somewhere, there was an encounter with Jesus that she gave him her life. She believed with head and with heart and yielded and accepted him and went back and couldn't help but tell the people that scorned her and rejected her. She was telling them about, and why did they listen? I mean, that's the question, isn't it? Here's the tension in the text here. Why in the world would they even listen? They hadn't listened to her before. I think the answer is they saw something different immediately. Jesus transformed her. Amen? Right then. I mean, in that moment, and they could tell, hey, something's different. Well, she's even talking. She's coming to be with us. She's saying something. And they listened to her. And check out the rest of the story. Come see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Messiah? They came out. They listened. And they made their way toward him. Verse 39 says, many of the Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I ever did. We've got a little snapshot of what the conversation was. Just a little small picture of what was taking place. But Jesus poured out his love to her, and she said, yes, I want this. I want this relationship. So when the Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed 2 days. And because of his words, many more became believers. Check this out. This encounter with Jesus, it changed everything. It changed her relationship with God, and it changed her relationship with others in the community. And it changed others in the community's relationship with God. Is that not a Jesus deal? That's who he is. That's what he does. He's in the transforming business. There's another story. It's in Mark's gospel. It's the demoniac from the Gerasenes, Gentile territory on the east side of the Sea of Galilee. And this man represents those who are just trapped in bondage. I mean, just trapped. And sometimes there's no way out other than Jesus. This man represents those who are addicted to maybe substances, drugs, alcohol, maybe even sex. Maybe even those who are addicted to things that we would consider good, like work. Workaholic. Maybe anger. Or even codependency. That covers a lot of us a lot of times. Maybe you're like me and you like those pies a little too much, and sometimes you just cope with life with an extra scoop of ice cream on top of it, huh? I mean, can we just be honest? We deal with things differently, don't we? We cope with things differently, and Jesus says, I want to be your coping mechanism. Will you give me your life? And this man, who was just untamable, lived in a graveyard, and the people there would try to tie him with chains, and he was so strong, supernatural strength from the demons that lived within, dwelt within, that he would just break the chains. There was a great fear of this man to the point of they were shunning him. They didn't want anything to do with him. And I doubt if people went and hung out in the graveyard just for a good time because they knew who was there. So they're trying to avoid him at all costs. I want you just to think about this. And yet the scripture says he came out to meet Jesus. Inside this man, there was a yearning and a longing to be whole and to be free, to be set free. There was still this longing. He came out to meet Jesus because the demons within didn't want any part of this, and they were the voice, the mouthpiece, if you will. What they were saying, he was the mouthpiece, and they were saying things that were just showing us the authority that Jesus has. Who are you? What do you want with us? Please. They used this phrase, swear to God. Now, isn't that interesting? A demon saying, swear to God that you won't torture us. Now, how ironic is that? This demon using the highest name that he knew, okay? Can I just tell you, the demons know, folks, who the authority is, and the authority is Jesus. Swear to God that you won't torture us. Another gospel talks about demons' fear of the abyss, talking about the abyss. They know their fate, okay? And so what this group of demons, however many, was saying is, please don't send us to our eternal demise yet. And for whatever reason, Jesus allowed them to go into a herd of pigs. Scripture says there were about 2,000 of them. Okay, what is that? What's up with this part of the story? What do we do with this? Can I just tell you, Jesus cares more about your soul than anything else in the world. There's not anything else in this world, on this earth, that is more important than your soul. You with me? He loves you. He created you. He desires to be in intimate relationship with you. My dad told me a story that I didn't remember just recently, this weekend. My grandfather raised hogs back in my early years before I could even really remember a lot of that. But it was the winter of 73. It was actually October. Major ice storm in southwest Iowa. And this was before hog confinements. The hogs of his just piled up, I guess, to stay warm and maybe just slipped into one another. Who knows the whole story? But, of course, those on the bottom didn't survive. He lost about two-thirds. Grasp this with me. This was more than two-thirds. This was the whole herd. This is 2,000. Okay? Is it a herd of hogs? What would that be? Bunch of them. I thought that probably brought some angst to those who owned. And knowing Jesus, he may have gone and met with those folks later separately. We don't know that story. But can I tell you this? You've got to pull this out of this. Jesus cares more about your soul than anything else in this world. He loves you, each of us. The lengths that he went to are just astronomical. There's nothing more important. Look at what takes place in verse 15. When they came to Jesus, they saw the man who had been possessed by the legion of demons sitting there, dressed and in his right mind. How about that? After encountering Jesus, the man even has some sanity now, is sitting clothed where he wasn't before, and people are seeing this, and they're like, what in the wide world? And look at their response. Is this not just odd? Here's some tension in the text for you. Wrestle with this with me, if you would. They were afraid. What in the world would they be afraid of? Jesus just healed probably the most evil creature that they could imagine at that time. He's sitting there in his right mind, and now their response is fear. What is up with that? I think it shows the degradation of the culture and the evil in that area and what was taking place, that they even associated now, when they saw the work of God, the hand of God move, they associated it with something negative in their hearts and minds, and they were afraid of it. But the story's not over there. This is remarkable here. Check this out with me, if you would. Those who had seen it told the people what had happened to the demon-possessed man and told about the pigs as well. Then the people began, look at this, to plead with Jesus to leave their region. Is that not where we are as a society? We're pleading with him to leave us alone. God, help us. And he did. As Jesus was getting in the boat, the man who had been demon-possessed begged him to go with him. Jesus, can I come with you? I want to be a part of your ministry. And Jesus says, yeah, but you stay here. Go home to your own people. Tell them how much the Lord has done for you, how he has had mercy on you. So the man went away, began to tell in the Decapolis, that area of 10 cities there in Gentile territory, how much Jesus had done for him. And all the people were amazed. And the next time Jesus puts his foot in this area, this geographical area, there are 4,000 people, men, that doesn't include the women and children, that Jesus feeds in that amazing miracle, because that guy got busy. Is that not amazing? They went from pleading for him to leave to hungry for him to share, spiritually and physically. Wow, that humbles me. That guy was doing the work what each of us are called to do. You see, this encounter with Jesus changed everything. His mental capacity, his mental health, his physical health. I mean, it just changed everything. And Jesus said, no, I need you. You're a living, walking, breathing demonstration of my grace at work in someone's life. And I need you here. That's the Jesus who wants to have a relationship with you. That is the great I am, the resurrection and the life. You've heard three biblical stories. I want you to hear a story from one of our own. And some of you have heard this before. This is Jenna Mateer, and she was baptized last month. But I just want you to hear her story afresh and anew today as we listen to the testimony of one who encountered Jesus.
Panic attacks. I would stay up every night just absolutely crying. I couldn't breathe. I felt like I hated God. Eight years old, I was diagnosed with anxiety and grew up, and I thought things, you know, my life's okay. And then once I had kids, I started dissecting different pieces of my life and really thinking about, if my child went through this, what would I think? The depression, the anxiety, it was all just too much. And after my son was diagnosed with cancer, it just kind of snowballed from there. I saw a comment on one of the pages that I'm on for childhood cancer. Someone had commented, if there is a God, then he must hate children with cancer. And I remember reading that and looking at my one-year-old son who had cancer. And I couldn't imagine anyone taking the disease that he had and applying that to everything else that he was. And I looked at my son, and he is smart, and he's funny, and he is so creative. What are these people talking about? You cannot take this one part of just this amazing, beautiful child and say, God hates them. And that was really the moment it solidified for me that God is real, God loves me, God loves my family, and God loves my son. That was just kind of the moment that I said, I'm done living by the rest of the world. I'm not gonna let people keep saying my son and his life are less than. Finally, one night, I told my husband, I said, we're going to church. I said, that's the only thing I can think of here. Once I started actually reading my Bible and studying my Bible and spending time with God, everything just started to make sense that this is a two-way relationship. I obviously still struggle with anxiety and things here and there. You know, my son still has cancer. He's 3.5 now, and he is still in active treatment. Before, there was that just constant dread of, I would just panic because I didn't know what was next, and I was terrified of the future. I didn't want to think about it. And now I'm so excited for the future just because we have that relationship with Jesus, and going forward, I know no matter what happens, we're going to be fine. My name is Jenna, and I have decided to follow Jesus.
Amen. Let's celebrate Jenna and her life. And last month, we celebrated baptism with 18 candidates, folks who decided they were ready to make that decision. That's a big deal here, and we celebrate that. And Jenna, we're so thankful for you and your family, Zach, the kids, Perseus, who she was referring to there, and they're all with us. And Penelope, would you guys mind just standing, and would you allow us to pray for you? We just love you, and we believe in prayer, and we're going to ask God to touch Perseus, aren't we, church? Can we pray? Father, we just need you today. We thank you for this dear family that you have brought to us. We thank you for their lives. We thank you for this new decision that Jenna has made for you. I thank you for the creation of Perseus, his life. You know all about him. And Lord, you know her decision in the midst of challenges and difficult situations. She's going to trust you regardless. And so, God, we're just asking that you touch this precious young man in your name today. We love you. Amen. Amen. We're proud of you guys. We're thankful for you. Thank you. Wow. Can I tell you, we believe in the power of prayer here. And here's the beauty of it. When we talk about healing, we know that Jesus heals in one of three ways, and he always heals. It's one of these three. Sometimes it's immediate, and we see those results, kind of like Lazarus, you know, when they saw him coming out. Another way is coping grace. He gives us the grace to just go on and deal with it, and sometimes it's what we call the ultimate healing, and that's going to be with him. And apparently he wasn't ready for me then, and he threw me back because of many of your prayers. Thank you. So could we just talk about spiritual healing for a moment before we go together? Because that prayer is answered instantaneously. If we pray a sincere prayer of faith, you all, God will hear that prayer immediately. This is remarkable to me, that if we ask God in repentance, and that word means that we're confessing our sins and we're going the other direction with his grace. Now, we were headed this way. Now we're going the complete opposite direction. We're living for him in obedience. If we pray that prayer in faith, trusting him, he will answer that and he will help us. Could I just invite you to bow your heads with me and close your eyes and just... The Holy Spirit is speaking to us today. I really believe that. In his word, he's speaking to us through this testimony. And I just want you to do a little business with God for a few moments today. It's a day of celebration. And I think this would honor him most on a day that we celebrate him and his life. The resurrection and the life wants to come and be your Savior, wants to live within your heart. Would you just let the Holy Spirit give you an exam today? If you want to pray a prayer of salvation in just a moment, I'm going to lead you through a prayer. You don't have to say it out loud. You can if you want to. But if you will pray this in your heart with sincerity, God will answer that prayer immediately. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, I admit and recognize that I'm a sinner. I understand that everyone has sinned. And so I recognize that I am a sinner. And I come to you in humility today. And I ask that you forgive me of my sin. I confess these before you. I turn in repentance. I want to follow you. And by your grace and only with your help can I do this. But with your grace and your help, we can do all things through Christ. So God, would you just work in my life today? I want to be your follower. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, in just a moment, I'm going to ask if you prayed that prayer to stand, just in a moment. But I'm also going to ask if you have something that you would like to pray about this morning to stand, that if there's just a need in your heart and life, that maybe there's a family member like Perseus that you just want to pray for, or maybe there's something that has happened, a situation, and you just need someone to come alongside you and to help you. Or maybe you just want to grow spiritually. You just want to go to another level in your relationship with Jesus. In just a moment, I'm going to ask if any of those apply to you, if you would just stand and let us celebrate you. And then I'm going to ask that you be dismissed, and there's some folks that would love to pray with you. If you fall into any of those categories, would you just stand this morning and let us tell you how much we love you and appreciate you here today? Anyone? Oh, we're proud of you. We love you. We thank you. We need you. And we're with you. Church, can we celebrate this morning? Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. We're going to sing a song. As we sing, if you'll just make your way down the aisle, right out this door here, the ushers here will guide you, and just right across, there's a team that wants to just encourage you and pray for you today. That's all it is. No Kool-Aid involved, okay? We just want you to know we love you and are for you here together today, all right? Yay, God. Thank you, Jesus. The resurrection and the life. Lead us, Andy. Thank you.
I'm going to start the song with verse 3.
Stand with us.
We're going to end on a high note. We're going to send you out with a new name written down in glory. You are loved and you are dismissed.